Hi, this is Pat with Pat's Two Cents. We're God's Church of Love Online. And God wants you to know, no matter what you're going through, no matter what's going on around us, God is in control. And He wants you to be patient. He does not want you flying off the handle or losing your grip. Amen. Let's go on with His word. We are in James chapter 5, starting at verse 1. Go to now, ye rich men, weep and howl for your miseries that shall come upon you. God is talking to the powers that be. Your riches are corrupted, and your garments are moth-eaten. Your gold and silver is cankered, and the rust of them shall be a witness against you, and shall eat your flesh as it were fire. Ye have heaped treasures together for the last days. Behold, the hire of the laborers who have reaped down your fields, which is of you kept back by fraud, crieth, and the cries of them which have reaped are entered into the ears of the Lord of Sabaoth. That is the verse that jumped out to me. God wants you to know He hears your cry. He hears the longings of your heart. He knows what you're going through. Verse 5, talking to the powers that be. Ye have lived in pleasure on the earth and been wanting. Ye have nourished your hearts as in the day of slaughter. Ye have condemned and killed the just, and He doth not resist you. Now God's word to you that are crying out to Him, verbally or silently. Be patient therefore, brethren, unto the coming of the Lord. Behold, the husbandman waiteth for the precious fruit of the earth, and has long patience for it, until he receive the early and latter rain. Verse 8, be ye also patient, establish your heart, for the coming of the Lord draweth nigh. Now, I'm stopping there. Many of you have been going through a variety of the strangest trials, frustrations, and challenges in these last couple of years. It almost looks like you're living in a storybook existence, like, I don't really believe this is real. It's more like a nightmare or a bad dream. And unfortunately, a lot of what's going on is real. Unfortunately, we are under almost a regime that takes more care of the rich. The rich, the powerful, those with clout, those with pull and influence. Those who are popular with a big name, and the ones who society thinks very little of, if they think of them at all. They are the ones that need the most and get the least. So God is letting you know that He has not forgotten. He is not taking care of the affluent. He is there for you. The what society would call the nobodies of society, the insignificance of society. The reason I say it like that is because in His word, when He talks about people who bless other people, He says, when you have done it unto the least of these, you have done it unto me. So know that God is mindful of the people who don't even come to mind, the people who don't even count. Some of you that are hearing my voice are incarcerated. And you think because you blew it and you're paying the penalty that God has written you off. No, He has not. No, He has not. Many of you, some of you are caught up in prostitution. And you can't seem to cut loose. You can't seem to break free because there's a heavy hand of oppression over your life. God knows. So the thing to start praying is for God to make a way of escape for you. And when you see that way, take it. Don't hesitate. Trust God to protect you all the way to your freedom. Now that's for some of you who are in extreme circumstances. For the average Joe like you and me, know that even though you don't make a lot, even though you haven't accomplished a lot, even though you may have a longer list of failures than you do of successes, that does not describe who you are in God's heart. A lot of things that we suffer in our lives can be from our own poor choices. It can be from associations. It could be from conditions out of our control. The bottom line is, God, if you have God in your life and in your heart, if you have Jesus as your Lord and Savior, if you're filled with His Holy Spirit and you're following His ways, I know you're not doing a perfect job of it, because the Bible says all fall short of the glory of God. So we all fall short. So nobody out there get the big head thinking you made it. You've arrived. You haven't. But no matter what, God is mindful of you. He knows what you're going through. He knows the yearnings, the longings, the cries of your heart. He hears you. That's what He's saying here. He hears you. Your cries are not falling on deaf ears. Just because your answer is not coming today or tomorrow does not mean it's not coming. I cried for 2 years while in a state of foreclosure, but my answer didn't come till almost 2.5 years. And this is my answer. I own a house in a senior gated community. So there are times when you have to go through the tears through it. That means you go in it, you go through it, you come out on the other end. You may be going through right now. You may be right in the middle of the tunnel. You don't see the light at the end of the tunnel because there are too many curves. You can't pick up any source of light. So you feel like your life is dead in the darkness. And you're wondering, what is God doing in all of this? How can God come out with a blessing when everything in your life right now feels like you're either being punished, penalized, or you're being cursed? And I'm telling you, what God has blessed cannot be cursed. So understand that even though you're going through this dark spell, the glory's on the other end. Think of the end of Job. What happened? He went through 7 years of affliction, loss, deaths, mourning, all kind of stuff. And he suffered in his body for 7 years. But he still did not complain against God. He did not blame God. He didn't like it, but he knew where his trust was. And God blessed him so much more once he came out on the other side. God blessed him. So there may seem times when you don't understand, why are you going through this? Why is this happening? Why has that answer not come yet? God is working out the details. And he does his best work in the dark. When you look at the tree out in the sunlight and it looks full grown and the leaves are on the tree, oh, that looks so pretty. That's a beautiful fruition of growth of a plant. Somebody that planted something in the ground, that's the fruition. But there's a whole lot of stuff that goes on in the dark. Germination. All kind of insects that do things under the dirt. You can't see it. It's happening when the sun goes down, when the moon comes up, and it's dark outside. And you don't understand what's happening in nature when everybody's in the bed, but all the little insects, the night insects, are awake. And they're doing things around the roots of that little tree. Well, there are a lot of things that are germinating, a lot of things that are coming to fruition. You can't see it yet because it hasn't broken ground. But God has already planted your blessing. God is already working on your detail. He's working out your case. Don't think that because you don't see his hand, that he's in Hawaii somewhere having a little vacation while you're suffering. See, God is not Congress. Remember that. I know a lot of times Congress goes out and they take their vacation while they leave the poorest of the poor hanging, hurting, doing without. That's not God. I don't care where you can't see him. I don't care how badly you can't hear him or feel him. He is ever present. He is all knowing and he's all powerful and he's able to get it done. And he's working on it. That's what I love about him. He's working on it. Some of you are waiting for your loved ones to get saved. I remember years ago when I didn't want to hear about church. Don't talk to me about God. I don't want to hear all that Jesus talk. Leave me alone. But I noticed I was going to the nightclub that I had been going to. And I'm starting to get tired. Tired of the BS. Tired of everybody talking smack, saying nothing. Talking loud, saying nothing. Talk, 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 doing nothing. Being about nothing. Nothing from nothing leaves nothing. Remember that song? Nothing from nothing leaves nothing. Yeah. Well, see, this is what ends up happening. While I'm sitting here listening to all of this nothingness around me, I'm getting tired. I'm getting bored. But I'm not aware that my next door neighbor is on her knees praying that God takes my appetite away for sin. That sin loses that nice taste that I like. That I get bored with it. That I get tired of it. That's exactly what happened. Now that was a process of about 4 or 5 years. But when I was 27, baby, I was ready for a change. And that's when I gave my heart to the Lord. And it was after that that she revealed to me that that was her prayer. And it made sense. That's why I went through that all those years. I was just losing the interest. It was all, I was sick and tired of being sick and tired. So what God is trying to let you know is he's working out your details. He's answering your prayers. He knows the longings and the cries of your heart. I wasn't even saved, but God was still. He was still looking after me. All right, let's go to, what's the next one here? Let's go to Romans chapter 5. Go with me to Romans. Romans. All right. Romans chapter 5. Starting at verse 1. Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom also we have access by faith into this grace wherein we stand, and rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. And not only so, but we glory in tribulation also, knowing that tribulation worketh patience, and patience experience, and experience hope. And hope makes not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given unto us. Amen. Now, this is what I want to say to you about that. There are times when, I know I said before, God sometimes does his greatest works in the dark. There are times when you will get more experience from God when you're going through something than when everything is going fine. I noticed that. When I really desperately need him, I get more of an encounter. When I'm more in need, when I feel like I'm more in need than when I'm not. So know that when tribulation worketh patience. I remember one time I called my father. I was on the freeway and I told him that my fan belt had busted. And he said, okay, give me about 15 to 30 minutes. I'll be there. Just, you know, just sit in the car, close the door and just wait for me. Now, when the fan belt first busted, first thing I'm thinking about is being stranded on the highway. And then I ran over to the call box, and when I was able to reach my father and he said, I'll be there, I was able to sit in my car, turn the radio on, and chill. I wasn't worried, am I going to be stranded on the freeway? I wasn't wondering, is it going to be hours? No, because my father told me he would be there. And because he told me he would be there, I knew I was all right. Now, there are times when you're going through tribulations, you're going through trials, you're going through challenges, you're going through frustrated avenues in your life. And you don't like it. It's painful. It can be quite scary. It can feel quite precarious. But what God is trying to remind you is he'll be right there. He hasn't gone anywhere. He's a very present help in trouble. So know that God is not going to abandon you. And that is what enables us to be patient in tribulation. Is knowing how faithful, knowing how dependable, knowing how able and how present God is in times of need. See, when you know in whom you believe, you don't hit the panic button like you would if you're out there fending for yourself. If I didn't have a father to call on when my car broke down, if I didn't have a father I could count on when I needed advice or I needed help, I would have been a whole different person. My reactions would have been a lot more, it would have been a lot crazier, let's put it like that. But because I had a father I knew I could depend on, who was a man of his word, I didn't have to wonder if he would say, I'll do but not do. I'll be there and not show up. I didn't have to worry about that. So that helps me. I know some of you didn't have it, and it makes it harder to trust God. But if you have anybody in your life that you knew you could depend on, think about them when you think about God. And know that God is a million times more faithful, more dependable, more able. That will help. And I know in these precarious times, it does feel like, well, what's it all about, Alfie? What's going to happen to me? What's it going to be like 6 months from now? What's going to happen in my body? What's going to happen in my pocketbook? What's going to happen in my car? What's going to happen in my house? Am I going to keep my house? Am I going to be have my utilities turned off? Am I going to be able to buy food? You know what? God shall supply all your needs according to his riches and glory. You're not alone. That's why they call Jesus Emmanuel, God with us. He's right here. He's with us, all of us. And he's mindful, very mindful of you. You're not a wallflower. You're not an oops. He's mindful of you. All right. Be encouraged here. You be encouraged. When you feel like you don't have much to offer, and some of you feel that way, when you feel like you don't have much to offer, when you feel like all your usefulness is run dry, baby, if God can create a river in the desert, He can create beauty. He can bring things out of you you didn't even know was there. That's why you must depend on Him. No matter what's going wrong in your life, no matter what challenges are before you, no matter how hopeless it may look and how little help is out there, God is a very present help. See, when He says, "With tribulation worketh patience," let me put it in everyday English, "and patience worketh experience, and experience works hope." When you experience God coming to your rescue again and again and again and again, guess what? Your hope grows bigger and bigger, and it increases your faith. But you cannot experience or know how faithful God is if you have no need. That's why you will find that the poor are rich in faith, because they have so many more needs, whether they're emotional, psychological, physical, or financial. The poor, in every sense of that word, have way more needs than the rich. So the poor, they get to experience God way more frequently because their needs are more dire and way more frequent. The more needs you have, the more deficits are in your soul, the more holes you've got in your soul, the more damage has been done in your life, the more damage you've done. And you cry out to God, that's when you really get to see those miracles. Because God responds to hunger and need. He's a very present help. I don't know how many other ways to say it. But God is able to do the impossible. God is able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above, way above all that you could ask or think. And you know, we can think some abundance up there according to His riches and glory, according to the power that works in you. I had two scriptures going at the same time. Sorry. But God shall supply all your needs according to His riches and glory. And God is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that you can ask or think, according to the power that works in us. And your power is right there tied in with your faith. If you lack faith, ask God to give you more faith, to help your faith. Help thou mine unbelief, Lord. I can't see the way out. I can't see how you can do it. But guess what? God's ways are above our ways and His thoughts above our thoughts. So there's no way for us to figure Him out. But He's got it all figured out, y'all. And He will work out your situation for your good. All things work together for our good, for those who love God and who are called according to His purpose. God bless you and be encouraged. God is for you. And if God be for you, who can be against you? You hear me? So you be patient and you wait, for the coming of the Lord draweth nigh. You hear me? Amen. God bless you.